Welcome to Type C Tech Reviews. Today we're going to be doing a review of the Alienware AW3225QF. If you want to check this exact same monitor out, there's Amazon links below, 40 US, UK, Canada, and international links. But let's jump into it. This is a 31.6 inch slightly curved screen size with a resolution of 3840 by 2160 or 4K. Now this gives you a PPI of around 140 pixels per inch. This means how the image is actually going to appear to your eye is very, very crisp and clear. Now obviously the biggest point with this monitor is that it is a QD OLED or a quantum dot OLED, which is produced by Samsung or manufactured by Samsung. It is the Gen 3 version of this panel. Now, text clarity on OLEDs has always been an issue. However, the Gen 3 panels made significant improvements here on the 27 inch variant of this monitor, but on this 32 inch, it is basically a non-issue. Because the resolution is so much greater, going from 1440p to a 4K resolution, even at this 32 inch screen size, it makes the PPI significantly more dense. And from my typical viewing distance, it's essentially impossible to see. Only occasionally, if you stare at text closely, you can see the different red and green colors separate, but overall a non-issue, and I think most people will never notice this. It is so much better than the 27 inch variant, which was already so much better than the previous variants. Now, for those of you that this caused eye strain, I've seen comments where people say the text clarity issues on these OLEDs caused me eye strain. I would probably go and try this monitor because I don't think you're going to have problems with eye strain because it's so much better. It all but pretty much eliminates that problem with this panel. All right, now before we get into the ports, let's talk about the finish. This is glossy here. And oh, is it glorious. This panel is absolutely stunning. The clarity is phenomenal because there's no matte finish, which does degrade picture quality. Now, this still suffers from not having a polarization layer, which causes this panel to appear purple when light from the environment hits it. This means even though the pixels can literally turn off, making for an infinite black contrast ratio, which is giving you really true blacks. That's the big deal with OLEDs, right? Well, because this doesn't have a polarization layer, you have to be in a dimmer or dark room to actually see that true black. However, this is not as much of an issue as I think it sounds like, or at least to me it isn't. One is the room doesn't have to be absolutely dark. You really just don't want direct reflections hitting off of the panel. So having your lights dimmed and maybe some curtains is pretty much enough to get the best experience here. All right, but let's talk ports. This has one DisplayPort 1.4, two HDMI 2.1s, one USB type B upstream, and then two USB type A's in the rear with the other ports. You then get an additional USB type A and a USB type C on the bottom shin for quick access. And one note here is that you don't actually need that USB type B upstream connected to your PC to get power to the USB. So if you just need to plug in your headset to charge it, you can do that without any upstream port connected. Now for the refresh rate and variable refresh rate, this is 240 Hertz. Like, yeah, it's an expensive monitor for sure, but the fact that you're getting 4K, a 32 inch screen size, and the 240 Hertz on top of that, you better have a 4090 or something of that tier. That is what I tested this with, and really that's what you're gonna want. If you don't already have the top graphics cards, you're probably gonna wanna get them before you get this monitor. Now, this is also certified NVIDIA G-Sync compatible, so it is fully certified from NVIDIA, but this does not have FreeSync. All right, now before we move on, let's talk flickering. I know some people mentioned flickering on the 27 inch variant, so I decided to cover it here. Through all of my tests with this panel, which to be clear, it does have the current firmware update, so this is fully up to date. This did not seem to flicker for me at all. Possibly this is isolated to the 27 inch variant, although I also never noticed flickering on that panel. However, certain people can be more prone to seeing and noticing flickers than others, so do take what I'm saying with a grain of salt, but also I just think like maybe that's a quality control issue because I never noticed it on my panels at all, and obviously I've noticed flickering before on other monitors that we've gone through and tested, so I don't know there. That's kind of interesting, but I don't have any info on that. But one of the biggest and most important sections of this video is the brightness, SDR and HDR. Let's talk about it. This is a big section. Realistic brightness figures here in nits are mid to high 200s, essentially the exact same as the 27 inch variant. Now, when compared to the LG variants from LG themselves, Corsair and Asus, this is significantly brighter, not to mention actually looking beautiful as this panel is glossy, unlike those which had that horribly thick matte finish. Highlights here get nice and bright, and overall, this is exactly what I need. I never thought it was too bright or that I really needed more brightness to enjoy, both when gaming in the day as well as just doing typical workflow productivity with the windows open. This is during the day, not just at night. So while absolutely would I love 400 nits, yes, but I never actually felt like I needed more. Whereas on that LG panel, I did find myself going, this is way too dim. It's not pretty, it's not bright enough. Even in a totally dark room, that panel needed to be brightener, in my opinion, for my enjoyability. This one, it's like just right here. Now, continuing on with brightness, let's talk about ABL. That's the brightness consistently changing, which is on almost every OLED I think that's out. In SDR, this is disabled. So there is no ABL in SDR, which is great. So no brightness wildly changing when the colors or whites change on screen. This is a huge attraction to this monitor. However, especially with the HDR 1000 mode, ABL is intense and quite honestly ruins games for me. Now, partially because of this, the overall screen brightness gets significantly lower than the HDR true black setting, which is what I use 90% of the time. This was actually pretty much the same story with the AW2725DF. HDR 1000 has a more intense ABL, most of the time in game, making it way dimmer overall. So for HDR, the HDR True Black setting actually has like higher brightness overall. It's just a prettier, more enjoyable gaming experience when you are doing it in HDR, which, let's be clear, it's stunning. Like, the image is absolutely beautiful. I do believe that this is probably the single most beautiful monitor I have ever gamed on at any point in my life. It is that good. It is so good. The HDR tuning on this is phenomenal. You can literally use this in HDR all of the time. And I do mean 100% of the time. On desktop, you're not seeing any weirdness like washing out. It's just absolutely beautiful. And just like writing notes, desktops, nothing is overblown or overdone, which is very, very common. So this is actually very uncommon to see. But if you wanted to just leave it in HDR 100% of the time, you can. And I think that's a really big pro. And the last thing to note with HDR is Dolby Vision. Initially, when this came out, there was a bunch of issues with Dolby Vision, as Windows would force Dolby Vision all the time, making for just horribly bad looking things because it was forcing Dolby Vision when it wasn't Dolby Vision content. Now, this was actually not Dell or Alienware's fault at all. However, they very quickly made a fix for that, which is to toggle on and off Dolby Vision. So when you want to use Dolby Vision, you click the toggle in the menu system, and when you don't want to use it, you turn it off, and that basically solves the problem that Windows actually had themselves. Like, it was kind of their fault. So that's pretty cool. But with that, let's talk about colors, because they are intensely stunning here. Coverage is absolutely immense here, covering over 99% of the DCI-P3 color gamut. Now, interestingly enough, out of the box accuracy here in certain modes was actually extremely good. I expected this, as this is calibrated. However, the 27-inch variant was not as color accurate as I was expecting out of the box. And I was expecting the 27-inch variant to do what this monitor did. So I don't know why there's differences there, but the 32-inch does seem like it's better calibrated out of the box from the factory. This may be due to me receiving the 32-inch variant longer after the initial production, whereas the 27-inch, it was much closer to the beginning of production. So maybe the discrepancy is manufacturing or production or calibrated related. Like, maybe it's related to that, or maybe there just is a discrepancy between the 32 and the 27-inch variants. Either way, the colors here are absolutely gorgeous, and this monitor is fully capable of doing professional photo and video editing. Now, diving deeper in there, colors are oversaturated in SDR. The first time opening games, they look absolutely beautiful, albeit not totally perfectly accurate, but possibly the most vibrant monitor I've ever seen used just in SDR. I didn't end up noticing any annoyances, especially with skin tones, which I was looking directly for. And personally, I actually prefer this to be a little bit less accurate, but a little oversaturated, as I think they did it well. And games, like, seriously, games in SDR are just crazy vibrant, especially reds. I'm an OG Battlefield 1 player, and some of the fields with these red roses, flowers, it's literally, I just paused and looked at it for quite a while because of how vibrant it was. It's very, very cool. Now, response time and ghosting. This is a quick section because, well, it's an OLED. The pixel response time is pretty much as quick as we can get it right now. And like I've said before, the visual differences between a fast IPS panel and an OLED isn't as great as many reviewers initially said, but Regardless, this is just about as good as you can currently get, being essentially crystal clear. All right, now before we move on, let's talk about an issue that they had right out of the gate with this monitor, and that was the screen being very, very scratched due to packaging. Now, this seems to be fixed and my monitor is flawless, so that's good. However, this speaks not actually to the packaging that this initially came in, but just how delicate the panel could be. I don't want to say is, but could be. To the touch, the panel itself is kind of grippy, and only using this for 2 or so weeks, it seems like it could be extremely prone to scratching, which does make me worried for long-term usage when cleaning the screen. I would definitely be more inclined to use compressed air rather than a microfiber cloth, which they did include a microfiber cloth in the box, so they do expect you to use that. However, the screen does seem like it's significantly more delicate. However, I will be using the included microfiber cloth because that's what they sent it with, and I will be doing update videos on burn-in, durability, and really if I think the monitor is worth it at the 3-month mark, 6-month mark, and then a 1-year mark, and see if there's any issues that need to be gone over, and also we'll be able to see how burn-in is doing and things like that. So definitely subscribe below if you want to stay informed for the long-term test of this monitor. It's the first time I'm ever doing it, and I'm very excited. But with that, let's talk stand and build quality. This is Alienware. They get it right here. You have height, tilt, swivel, but actually no rotation here, and this is because I believe they would need to redesign the part of the stand to accommodate that larger screen size. However, the cable management is perfect here. Cables come out of the bottom, so it's extremely easy to make sure you never see the cables. In addition, you also have a cover that goes over those ports. So if you do have a setup where the monitor is facing somewhere where someone sees the back of that monitor, this looks super clean, which is very cool. Now, most of my setups are against the wall, but huge benefit if it's not. Now, for menu system and controls, it's classic Dell Alienware here. It's functional with no real learning curve using the joystick and the dedicated on and off switch, but the graphics are also not super special, and I feel like they should update this. However, definitely not a deal breaker. For mounting, you can definitely mount this with 100 millimeter by 100 millimeter VESA mounts. And one of the quirks is that this does have RGB. It has a 32 on the rear left side and then an Alienware logo on the right. This is only really cool if the back of your monitor can be seen, so not a against the wall setup. And this is because if you do have it against the wall, while the RGB is bright enough to hit the wall, it's inconsistent. It's bigger on the left side with the 32 and smaller on the right, and it's a different shape. So it just looks a little bit weird. However, if the back of your monitor is facing somewhere where someone will see it, it does look freaking awesome. All right, now before we get to the most important section of the video, which is price and value, let's talk about burn-in. Now, they have some measures like pixel refresh and pixel shift to help mitigate burn-in, but OLEDs will burn in over time. It just happens as this technology does break down. You're most likely not going to keep this for 10 years like you could an IPS-based panel. So if your goal is to keep something long-term and spend a lot of money on a good one, this is not really the thing that you should do. It's not that kind of panel. And that's okay, but you do need to go in educated. You should really only get this panel if you have enough disposable income to be okay with only using this for 3 to 5 years and paying for that experience. The other thing to mention is that these probably will depreciate and have very little value after 1 or 2 or 3 years because most people will probably not want to get a used OLED that probably will have some amount of burn-in on it. Also, not to mention the fact that it could be very difficult to sell a monitor that will have some amount of burn-in, as we've seen how freaking difficult it is for these refurbished and used phone companies that had phones with these OLEDs. That's been a big issue that a lot of people will return these phones, a bunch of things like that. So just keep in mind that after you purchase this and you use it, it probably won't be worth anything. You're probably just gonna spend all of that money on that 3 to 5 years of the experience. That's really great. However, if you have the money, this is for sure the one that I would get. The 27 inch is awesome, and honestly, the value there is a lot better and definitely easier to stomach. So if that's the position you're in, the 27 inch makes more sense value-wise, but this experience is special. The 4K 32 inch screen size and slightly being curved is just a freaking unbelievable experience. But with that, let's talk about price and value and should you buy it? Well, the value is actually really, really good here. Coming in at $1,199.99, this is definitely not cheap. However, the value is immense. This is a 4K 240Hz, slightly curved, has the best picture quality of any monitor currently available to the public, jaw-dropping colors with the great out-of-the-box accuracy, the best text clarity of any OLED available, Dell's 3-year OLED burn-in warranty, and extremely fast ghosting. If you have the money to spend on this panel and have a big old graphics card, I highly recommend this monitor. This is the best OLED, in my opinion, to currently buy right now, with the best picture quality and solid performance, but also the least amount of compromises. Again, if you want to check it out, there are Amazon links below, 40 US, UK, Canada, and international links, and if you use those links, it does help support this channel, because this channel is very expensive to run. But yeah, this is Type C Tech Reviews, and I'll see you guys in the next video.